Penguin Audio presents The Areas of My Expertise, written and read by me, John Hodgman. Jonathan, would you go ahead and play the theme song, please?
Now is the time when the world really needs him. Wisdom is out of our reach. Out of the wasteland there comes a redeemer whose only desire is to teach. No waste your time at some fancy college. Forget that, it's too much to read. An audiobook of complete world knowledge is all you'll ever need.
You have purchased or stolen the full 95 CD audio instructional program entitled The Areas of My Expertise. That is actually the shorthand title for the program. You may be interested in the full title, which is as follows. An Almanac of Complete World Knowledge, compiled with instructive annotation and arranged in useful order by me, John Hodgman, a professional writer, in the areas of my expertise. Which areas include matters historical, matters literary, matters cryptozoological, hobo matters, food, drink, and cheese, which is a kind of food, lobsters, squirrels, and eels, haircuts, utopia, what will happen in the future, and most other subjects.
Most of the subjects include having asthma, tipping in fancy hotels, terrible haircuts, dungeons and dragons, monsters and magical spells. All of your travels are finally over. You're safe now, there's nothing to fear. So tip back a glass of your favorite beverage. You're lucky to be here. Cause tonight, you're holding a key that fits in a lock, opens the door, shows you a room that's holding a heart, that's pumping the blood, that's feeding your brain with information. Sweet information.
That was very nice, Jonathan.
Thank you, John.
The guitar sounds extra loud for some reason. Is it a new guitar?
No, it's the same old guitar. Maybe it's because you're hearing it through a microphone.
That could be. Maybe you're playing it with extra large hands today.
I do have my extra large hands on.
I thought so. Oh, hello, I see you have initiated the audio program. Good evening. My name is John Hodgman. I am not using a pseudonym. As you may know, I was once a professional literary agent and high-powered media insider. In my day, I represented some of the finest young writers of our time, negotiating the sale of their books to publishers, as well as their translation rights, screen rights, mustache fees, and bobblehead figurines. For this, I would receive a 15% commission, which is entirely standard, except for the bobblehead figurines, for which I received a 100% commission because I carved the figurines myself and my clients did not know that they existed. This is also entirely standard and should not be questioned. But that is all over now. As it is our common destiny to become that which we most loathe, so I have become that most wretched and predictable thing, a professional writer. Normally, I write short articles for magazines, which I find pleasing, as the process is usually over fairly quickly for both of us. But now I have gone and written a book. Believe me, this was the last thing I wanted to do, and I suspect the last thing you wanted as well. But I think we both knew it was inevitable. Certainly my publisher felt that it was, frequently pointing to my contract and its damned inevitability clause, which I should never have agreed to. But I did, and so now, here we are. I say good evening, though of course I don't know what time it is where you are. That is one of the defining sorrows of books and audiobooks, that we cannot see each other. Of course, it might have been different had my publisher inserted the camera I designed to fit snugly into your audio-playing device in order to spy on you, but this was determined to be too expensive and too illegal, and so we are left once again to our imaginations. The image I conjure of you, dear reader, begins with this audio recording, for if you are listening to these words, chances are you are probably listening to this audio recording of my book, or one so similar to it that it does not matter. Moreover, I may presume that you are listening to this book with your own ears, or possibly mechanical ears that replaced your own ears after a terrible accident. If I am correct, I may move on to deduce that you are a man or a woman. You are likely a person who has had some schooling, perhaps some training, for example, in reading and listening. What's more, if you are listening to this audiobook, you are probably near some kind of audio component. If you are driving while you are listening, you have use of at least one of your eyes, but I suspect you probably wear glasses, for people who read one book often go on to read another one, and then more and more, each longer than the last, and printed in increasingly painful fonts. Finally, I may conclude that you are a curious person who thirsts for knowledge, for this is, in fact, a compendium of complete world knowledge. Here you shall find the answers to all the questions you have been asking. For example, you ask, what is the truth about the Loch Ness Monster? The answer is provided. You ask, who were the U.S. presidents who had hooks for hands? The answer is provided. What was the menu at the first Thanksgiving, you ask, and did it include eels? Technically, that is two questions, but do not apologize, for I shall answer them both later. Like all, you wonder what will happen in the future. A simple chart of omens and portents provides the answer, and for the very first time in audiobook form, I will narrate this table to you. Of course, there have been books like this one before dealing with monsters and eels and history in the future. I am indebted to the long history of the Primer and the Reader, the Cyclopedia, and the Almanac. Since ancient times, almanackers sought the future from the stars and from animal entrails, forecasting the weather, the tides, and the phases of the moon. This was valuable work, of course, though really only useful to farmers and sailors and werewolves. It was Benjamin Franklin who realized that the form could offer more than just questionable meteorology, and so his Poor Richard's Almanac provided as well poetry, brief essays, and all kinds of unasked-for advice about when to wake up in the morning and how to electrocute yourself using only a kite and a pair of bifocals. I confess I am not a fan of this work, as Franklin seems to have been pretty sloppy, accidentally putting in Fs for every S, and you will note that he did use a pseudonym, so it is difficult to trust him. But even so, Poor Richard was exceedingly popular, and so the way was paved for a whole new genre of inexpensive popular reference books. The North American Almanac, The World of Wisdom, The Old Werewolf's Almanac Encyclopedia, to name a few, offering history and wisdom and guidance on diverse subjects well into the last century. It was not long ago that the average American home kept only two books at all, an almanac and a Bible, or else two almanacs, with one usually hidden in the wall to ward off ghosts. For they were an amazing innovation. At a time when most books were still intended only for scholars and aristocrats, often specifically fashioned to be held by foppish consumptive hands, here was a book for the average person. Here at last was a place where the typical lonely, miserable American could turn for the information he required on the lives of the vice presidents, the diseases of the horse, the rules of polite correspondence, the time required to digest certain foods, and naturally, on hobos. All gathered together in brief, easy-to-read articles, all ingeniously arranged, in no particular order whatsoever. But as inspiring as these books were to me, I think you will agree that mine is a new kind of almanac and handy desk reference, for none before it has condensed so much information into such a pleasant, compact, and easily concealed non-pseudonymous volume, and none has focused so single-mindedly on the areas of my expertise with such extensive illuminating commentary by me. On this point, I appreciate that it may be difficult to grasp how complete world knowledge may be contained within a single book or indeed 135 CDs. Some skeptics have pointed out that most libraries, for example, are physically larger than this book and thus must contain more knowledge. This seems logical, but I wish to point out first, many libraries contain several copies of the same book and audiobook, not to mention large areas of empty space called reading rooms, where children and vagrants and freelance magazine writers meet. This book is considerably more compact and contains no room for vagrants. Second, many libraries contain not only books of knowledge, but also a great number of novels. This is fine, but many novels historically are longer than they need to be and contain long sections that convey no knowledge. This is a structural matter more than anything else, because books are assembled of equal-sized batches of folded pages called signatures. There are often more pages than are required by the words. Thence arose the practice of padding a novel, named for the 18th century custom of physically upholstering the pages with velvet and horsehair in order to make a short book appear longer. This practice was discontinued when the vagrants found out about it, and it became common to open a novel and discover a vagrant sleeping inside of it. Instead, modern novelists now extend their works by including unnecessary additional words to the manuscript, sometimes at random, but more commonly in the form of long descriptions of cities and eyebrows and feelings. Third, please note that when I say vagrant, I am not talking about the unfortunate homeless souls who do not choose that life, but those few willful wanderers and train-riding tricksters who still believe that the hobo wars are going on. Beware them, for these hobo emulators are often worse than the actual hobos ever were themselves. Fourth and finally, the main advantage that this book has over libraries, and indeed all of its almanacian predecessors, is that all of the historical oddities and amazing true facts contained herein are lies made up by me. And it is this astonishing innovation that allows each entry to contain many more truths than if it were merely factual. If this last point seems confusing to you, consider the banal and truthful statement that follows. Frédéric Chopin was a Polish composer in the Romantic style who wrote primarily for the piano. I guess this is sort of interesting, as most facts are, but history has shown us again and again that facts are not what most humans believe. They are not that which moves most men and women to love or hate or joy or crime. Now compare this statement. Frédéric Chopin was a Polish composer in the Romantic style who was obsessed with ladybugs, often letting dozens of them gallop over his neck, arms, and long tapering fingers while playing the piano. Obviously, the lie is so much more compelling. It shocks the mind and plays on the reader's imagination with ladybug-covered hands. New resonances emerge and new melodies of insight, not just into the nature of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.